at Yale University. He's a professor of historical theology and director of the Jonathan Edwards Center Africa at the University of the Free State in Bloemfontein, a consultant for the doctoral program at Puritan Reformed Seminary here in Grand Rapids. Prior to arriving at Yale in 2007 and at the University of the Free State in 2014, he lectured in post-Reformation studies concerns 17th century Europe as well as 18th century New England theology. The author of The Art of Living to God, 2005, on the method of post-Reformation preaching, which is also going to be forthcoming. Recently, an article, Dutch translation of Petrus van Maastricht, Theoretical Practica Theologia, a tested translator. He's also published multiple articles in English, German, Dutch, Afrikaans, and done work in Nili.
Thank you for this invitation. It was a good order that I... So you were last month. I will try. And I hope to say something about the nature and definition of the ways in the Reformed tradition. The search in three decades in a sense that shows no signs of abating. Scholars of spoiled or gluttoned, dependent on your point of view. 5,000, making him one of the most studied figures in Christian thought, and most studied American intellectual figure before 1800. But the road to that Renaissance has been long and winding, and it is in its source of some fascination. On the one hand, Jonathan Edwards, hopeful and with evangelical pietism, thoroughly reformed and orthodox evangelicals of the late 18th century who sought to continue expounding Edwards' theology. Reformed or orthodox or all. And this challenge we trace back even early 19th century, for example, the Yale-Princeton theological anthropology. For example, even Charles Edwards, a pantheist. Although the appreciation of Edwards' philosophical thought continued to flourish from the mid-20th century onwards, an increasing critique and question of his orthodoxy and reformed character of theology is noticeable over the last decade, however. And three examples may illustrate the diverse interpretation of Edwards' theological thought. First, Edwards' formulation of the doctrine of Jonathan is understood as a heterodox, at least in the tradition of Jonathanism and its trajectories. I focus primarily on a single document wherein Edwards most distinctively lays out his understanding of the and definition of theology, a sermon of November 1739, published as the important and was a challenging and changing time for New England's history. War and awakenings shaped America's early history and theology in an unprecedented ways, in particular, following the Great Awakening, which is fixed to Edwards, a preacher, theologian, philosopher, missionary, pastor, artists such as John Wesley and George Whitefield, all contributed to division and realigned alliances in the British colony. The concern over Arminianism was expressed in a letter exchanges in March 1739 between Captain Benjamin Wright and the Reverend Benjamin Dolittle of Northfield, Massachusetts. Dolittle accused his parishioner Wright of having signified nothing of a desire of peace and love on his predecessors whose works are leading example of 17th century Protestant scholasticism, piety. They are both excellent. Turretin is polemical divinity in general, doctrine and practice and controversy, or as a universal system of divinity, and it is much better than Turretin, or any other book in the world except the Bible, in my opinion. Edward's generous commendation was in fact an echo of earlier praise commencing with Cotton Mather. After all, there is nothing that I can do with pleasure. Recommend to you Maastricht, his Theologica Theoretica Practica, that a minister of the gospel may be thoroughly furnished unto every good work, and in one or two quarto volumes enjoy a well-published library. I know not that the sun has ever shone upon a human composure that is equal to it. In fact, Maastricht's work was highly valued by well-known New England pastors and theologians such as Benjamin Maastricht in the same lofty terms as Edwards do. Edwards Amasa Park reported even that Jonathan Edwards Jr., the son of Jonathan Edwards, read Maastricht Theoretica Practica 7 times. In spite, or thanks to Maastricht's work, however, the what is suggested here is in these times of New England's contested theology and its practice, Edwards as a prime example of effectively communicating the fundamentals of Christian theology, Catholic in its trajectory and contemporary in its setting. And therefore, a brief analysis with historical theological commentary of his this is divinity. Leaving for the moment the question of Edwards' Thomistic inclination at this point, the homiletician of North commonly defined as the doctrine living to God. And he goes on in the sermon, and by some who seem to be more accurate, the doctrine of living to God by Christ. The first given definition, but commonly defined, stands in the trajectory reaching back to Petrus Ramus. Ramus defined what divinity or theology is, as the Theologica as Doctrina Bene Vivendi, which was echoed by William Perkins in The Golden Chain. The body of scripture is a doctrine sufficient to live well. And in turn, Perkins' student William Blood, in this, his teacher, and provided a concise definition of theology in the medulla Theologica as Doctrina Vivendi, and rendered in the English tradition that was also used by Edwards as the divinity doctrine of living to God. Ames' work was not only extraordinarily influential in early New England theology, but also belonged to Edwards' core works of study, Yale College and thereafter. But the second part concerning the definition, and according to Edwards, by some who seem to be more accurate, the doctrine of living to God. England's theologian and philosopher provided, and the hearers of Northampton were the recipients of a long understood definition of the quidsit of theology, but mediated by continental Protestant scholastics of the 17th century, reaching back another 100 years to another philosopher and theologian, Ramus. The question came to God by Christ. They all relate to this. Our living to God in Christ, perfect holiness and happiness in the full enjoyment of God hereafter. Returning to Edwards' Thomistic inclination, this seemed to be enforced by his third question sermon about the necessity of the knowledge of the thing in the Summa Theologica on the necessity of the nature and extent of sacred doctrine. The perceptible Thomistic quality in Edwards' view of theology, however, is advanced in considering his observation made in the sermon that there are two kinds of knowledge of the things of divinity, speculative and practical, or in other terms, natural and spiritual. The distinction of two kinds of knowledge, speculative and practical, is not only found in this sermon, but in other 1740, The Controversy Notebooks, 1738, in Religious Affections, Edward states, "There is in the mind only beholds the things in the exercise of a speculative faculty and the sense of the heart, wherein the mind don't only speculate and behold, but relishes and feels. The one is mere speculative knowledge, the other sensible knowledge, in which more than the mere intellect is concerned. Proper proof of the true and saving knowledge of God. The great note of that knowledge, which saves and makes happy, is that it is practical." This twofold kind of knowledge, then, is not only of great importance to the preacher of Northampton, given the attention in the doctrine and application section of the sermon to this inquiry, but also places Edward both in a long-standing trajectory of scholastic inquiry, whether theology is a science, scientia, or a wisdom, sapientia, as well the discussion of scholastic distinctions, both present in medieval and Protestant scholastic system of theology, the distinctions of the speculative and practical part of theology. With the rise of interest of the 13th century in Aristotle's writing, the discussion of the nature and extent of theology was formed in part by the philosopher's classification of the form of knowledge, science, and wisdom. Franciscans such as Alexander of Hales and Bonaventure insisted on an effective, practical, and experiential character of theology, excluding it from consideration as a scientia in the Aristotelian sense of a rational or speculative discipline. Aquinas, on the other hand, not only argues in the Summa Theologica, known to Edward during his studies and teaching at Yale College, that sacred doctrine is a science, but also raises the question whether sacred doctrine is a practical science, to which Thomas, reflecting Dominican theology, replied, "It is not a practical, but a speculative science." And these fairly broad lines of the character of theology find a culmination in Duns Scotus' formulation of theology. Scotus not only resonated with Franciscan theology, though integrated more Aristotelian philosophy than previously was accepted, but considered theology as a discipline oriented toward the ultimate goal of humanity in God, in essence, praxis, that is to say, a knowledge not known for itself, but directed to God. And this medieval scholastic discussion on the character of theology, expository to the matters of faith, whether theology is theoretical or practical, would resurface in the 16th and 17th century works of Roman Catholic and Protestant theologians, works that were known by Edwards via the library of his father or the libraries of Harvard and Yale College. In respect to the Roman Catholic tradition, Francisco Suarez, who was praised by Edwards as the best of the schoolmen, tended to present scholastic arguments for both the Scotistic and Thomistic tradition, whereby the practica was not rejected altogether, yet opted for a modified Thomistic position. Concerning the Protestant theologians, Lutherans, such as Johann Gerhard, as well Reformed thinkers, such as Keckerman and Musculus and Vermigli of the 17th century, with the Reformed theologians of the 17th century, such as Coxeus and Macovius, works that were known to Edwards, recognized theology as a mixed discipline, both theoretica and practica, though leaning towards the practica, but rejecting its anthropological character as proposed by the Remonstrants. However, Edwards' inquiry whether theology is speculative or practica was raised in particular in the prolegomena of the Protestant scholastic theology of Maastricht and Turreten, theologians with whom Edwards was deeply acquainted. Turreten raised the question explicitly, is theology theoretical or practical? inquiry, not only about the understanding of the essence of theology, but also on account of controversies of this time, as Turretin says, such as the Remonstrants and Socinians, a concern Maastricht shared. Turretin asserts furthermore that a theoretical and speculative contemplation alone with knowledge as it op- therefore the Genevan theologian concludes, theology is neither theoretical nor practical, but a mixed discipline, and yet more practical than speculative, which appear, Turretin explains, from its ultimate goal, which is practice. Indeed, nothing in theology is theoretical to such a degree and so remote from practice that it does not bring about the admiration and worship of God. Nor is a theory salvific unless it is referred to practice. In addition to Turretin's question whether theology is speculative or practical, Edward's most favorite theologian Maastricht also discusses whether discipline is theoretica practica. Although Maastricht does not reject the Thomistic position altogether, Maastricht is inclined to follow a modified Scotistic position on the issue, proposing that the praxis is defined as doctrina, known for the sake of the end toward which it directs the knower. In other words, Maastricht aims to maintain a balance between the speculative and the practica, expressed in the conjunction theoretica, conjunction practica, yet oriented to the practicum. In summary, we note the reception and appropriation of all the scholastic models, as Richard Müller has argued, by these post-Reformation Reformed theologians. The continuity of the inquiry and the formulation of the understanding of the character of theology in both Roman Catholic and Protestant traditions, both that were acquainted, Edward was acquainted with, shows the catholicity of the theological enterprise. The appropriation of the theological inquiry is specific for post-Reformation theologians such as Maastricht and Turretin, while the alternative model of theology offered by the Remonstrants or Arminius is fundamentally different, a rejection of the recognition of theology as a mixed discipline. Simon Episcopius, for example, also read by Edwards, with the rise of the Arminianism in New England, had argued, there is nothing in the whole of theology that is not directed toward action. In other words, theology is not speculative, but fundamentally anthropocentric drive to praxis, which was a departure from the theocentric character of Reformed theology, a prevailing concern for Edwards as well. Although Edwards' inquiry into the nature and definition of theology stands in continuity with the Protestant and medieval scholastic inquiry, along with the attention to the scholastic distinctions, such as speculative and practical, the quest remains, as Edwards phrased it, for what kind of knowledge is divinity is intended. In the sermon on Christian knowledge, he points out to the hearers of Northampton that the difference between having the right speculative knowledge notion of the doctrines contained in the Word of God and having a due sense of them in the heart does not imply that neither of these is intended exclusive of the other. But he declares, it is intended that we should seek the former, speculative, in order to the latter, the practica. This is for Edwards the greatest importance for, as he reminds his readers, a speculative knowledge of the Word of God without a spiritual knowledge is vain and to no purpose. Yet, speculative knowledge is also of infinite importance in this respect, that without it, we can have no spiritual or practical knowledge. We may infer from this that Edwards does not reject the speculative entirely, as he assigns significant importance to it. Seek, he counsels in the application of the sermon, a good rational knowledge of the things of divinity. Yet, seeking the speculative comes not at the expense but in support of the spiritual knowledge or practice. In summary, we know the reception of all the Protestant scholastic models by Edwards. Not only is a similar inquiry on the nature and definition of theology employed by the preacher at Northampton and post-Reformation Reformed theologians, but also a discerning on Edwards' part of the character of theology following Maastricht, in my opinion, more than Turretin as a balanced theoretica practica theology. And with that, Edwards positioned himself on the one hand in continuity with classical theology, rooted in post-Reformation Reformed, I think the Franciscan Scotistic tradition, and on the other hand over against its challengers, the Arminians and the Deists. His familiarity with Episcopius, identified by Edwards as the greatest Arminian, and the Deists, such as Thomas Chubb, whose writing Edwards refutes later, in particular, strengthens Edwards' point in defining the essence of theology in these transformative years of New England's history and theology. However, the appropriation of former models of classical theology by Edwards provide a rather contemporized problem and prospect. In regard to the latter, Edwards assessed and equated the deism of his time with the tendencies of socinism of the previous centuries. Thus he not only provided his vast knowledge of post-Reformation systema as an approach for assessing contemporary challenges and proposed changes, but these systema also presented him with precise and nuanced definitions of the discipline, indispensable for the interpretation of events and formulation of his own views. Although Edwards carefully argued the importance and advantage of a thorough knowledge of divinity to his congregation in 1739, his argument continues to pose a challenge to the modern reader as well. The discourse is in a language other than Latin, the language of post-Reformation and medieval sources. The continuity of the intellectual trajectory of theological language, definitions and distinctions from the medieval period to Edwards' study at Northampton became instantly absent in translation to the great majority of his listeners. Not that his hearers in the pew would be aware of such, most probably, or that Edwards' message was deficient by it. However, the significance of Edwards as theologian in these transformative years of New England may be lost as well, at least to most Edwards scholars. And therefore, the proposed understanding of this homily must be placed as fundamental to our understanding of Edwards' theology and his much later published and major works against Arminianism and deism, such as The Freedom of the Will and Original Sin, as his controversies notebook dating from the 1730s onwards attests. In conclusion, in the midst of the challenging and changing years of 1737-42 in New England religious history, Edwards revisited fundamental questions of the theological prolegomena. Formulation of his answers demonstrated not only continuity and discontinuity, but also a demanding appropriation of intellectual thought, that of the catholicity and classicality of the nature and definition of theology. The discourse was drafted and heard in Northampton, published in 1788, and soon afterwards forgotten. Yet its message was timeless, as he closed his sermon: "Practice according to what knowledge you have. This will be the way to know more."